Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our pathology understanding for residents and students Pursue 6A series. Today we have liver pathology, and with us we have Dr. Raja Guru, who is a postgraduate from PGI Chandigarh, a diplomat of National Board, a specialist pathologist from Al Salam Hospital, Kuwait. He's a very reputed pathologist and has interest in GI and liver pathology. And he has an international name in liver and GI pathology with many multiple international publications. And who better than him to teach us what liver biopsy is all about? So welcome Dr. Raja Guru to the show. Please take over. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for this warm introduction about me. So I'll just share my screen right away. I hope you are able to see my screen.
Yeah, your screen is on the way. Yeah, we can see your screen.
I hope I'm loud and clear.
Your voice is a bit squeaky. It's okay.
Okay. Is it fine now?
Yeah. Can I ask other people? Can you hear Dr. Raja Guru clearly? Anybody can just unmute and say. Can you hear Dr. Raja Guru, everybody, clearly?
Hello, sir. Good evening. It's mildly husky, or you know what to say. It's not as clear, but it's okay, sir.
Okay. How about now? Am I audible now? I'm trying to use my maximum voice.
Yes, sir. Volume is fine, sir. That is mildly. Yes, sir. You can go ahead, sir. Actually, please.
Your volume is fine. It's slightly echoing.
Okay. Well, because I'm in a actually. That is why
I think we'll get adjusted to that. Please start. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everyone. We'll start with liver biopsy interpretation. But in this talk, I've used this whole PowerPoint. I've divided it into two. That is today's session. We will be covering a portion of it, and the next session will be on Friday, the same time, and we will be seeing the remaining presentations that time. One second, just hold on, please. I'll just. So, to start with, liver biopsy, basic introduction about... Just a minute, doctor.
Other people should not present their screen. Please don't present their screen. So, you need to come back again and start all the through. Somebody was presenting the screen, and that's the reason. Just present your screen, please. Requesting everybody else not to present their screen and not to unmute their mic, keep their mic muted. Yeah, Dr. Raja Guru, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, yeah.
Yeah, just present your screen. Yeah, please start. Okay. Thank you. Just present your screen, full screen.
Yeah. So, I'll just hide this. One second. Is it fine now? Are you not able to see my screen?
No, not yet. Yeah, it's fine now. It's coming. That's perfectly fine. Yeah, great. Now you make it full screen.
Is it fine now?
Yeah, absolutely fine. Please go ahead. Thank you so much. Sorry.
Okay. We start with a brief introduction to liver biopsy. It was first started by liver aspirate, and then later in 1920s, the percutaneous liver biopsy was done, and later in 1970s, Dr. Charles Dotter, a radiologist, mastered transtubular liver biopsy. It is practiced in both specialist and non-specialized centers. Like percutaneous liver biopsy can be done in any center, but transjugular biopsy might be done only in a specialized center. It always has to be that the benefit should outweigh the risk involved in performing such a biopsy. It requires a multidisciplinary effort with the clinical findings, the radiological findings, the lab findings, and the histopathological findings to come to a complete diagnosis in a liver biopsy. So this is on the whole what we are going to see in this two-day session, that is today and on Friday. We'll be seeing the indications, clinical details, the technical details, adequacy, how to approach a liver biopsy, the patterns involved, and challenges in routine reporting, what we will be facing while reporting a liver biopsy, and we'll be ending with that. So in this talk, I'll be talking only about the non-neoplastic liver biopsies. I'll not be talking about the neoplastic ones. So the type of biopsy is also very important. Before you start interpreting a biopsy, you have to know what type of biopsy it is. Either it is a percutaneous liver biopsy, a transjugular, or is it a laparoscopic or a wedge biopsy? Because suppose if it is a percutaneous or a laparoscopic liver biopsy, there are chances that the capsule might be sampled, and sometimes a person who is new to liver biopsy might interpret that capsule to be a fibrotic area, so it might result on to misinterpretation. As well as even in transjugular biopsy, so a part of the vein can be sampled, that also can give an impression of a fibrotic area, so that has to be kept in mind. And some pathologies are more quite evident on in the percutaneous biopsies. Like there are chances that the necrosis might be more prominent in the subcapsular area. So that area which will be sampled can result onto erroneous diagnosis. So we'll have to keep in mind before coming to a conclusion. So we'll have to know what type of biopsy it is. So coming on to the indications. So why do we need a liver biopsy? Most of the clinicians nowadays, they usually diagnose with the clinical and the serological findings, that is the lab parameters, they'll be able to come to a diagnosis. But in certain cases where there is a requirement of a grading and staging in an already clinical diagnosed or a serologically diagnosed liver biopsy, then a liver biopsy is required. And then it is clinically challenging. So there is no diagnosis which can be avoided by the physician, and they are asking for diagnosis. Then a liver biopsy would be required. And obviously, in a transplant setting, liver biopsy would be indicated. The clinical request form is very important because a liver biopsy request form in the previous institute where I was working. So it has a complete set of details where the clinician is just required to fill in all what is required for the pathologist to know, like all the lab investigations and other comorbid conditions and his clinical differential. So after seeing this, the pathologist can be very much satisfied with the findings which the patient has, and he can come to a conclusion of about what he wants to see in a liver biopsy. So in this case, it was diagnosed as chronic liver disease. So here what we actually require is to grade and stage the liver biopsy and not to come to a diagnosis, because this already has been made by the clinician. So a request form like this would be very helpful. Then the last one is the last parameter is also very important. We'll have to give importance to the biochemical parameters also. The viral markers, the autoimmune profile, the AST, ALT values, bilirubin values, the TGT and ALP. So we can come to an idea whether we are dealing with something like a cholestatic liver disease, or is it a viral hepatitis, or is it an autoimmune hepatitis. So we can come to an idea of what kind of pathology we are going to deal with when we are seeing the biopsy. So the picture might be more clearer when we put the slide on the microscope. So this is just an image of the block. So a nice long pore is there in all these blocks, and what we try to do is just remove the remaining VAT so that we can take maximum sections on a single slide. So if the VAT is there on the side, then the number of sections on a single slide may be less. But ideally, what we need to do is take only 18 sections. Each slide should have only 2 sections. And they will be pair mounted, like one slide will have 2 sections. And it is like the first slide and the last slide has to be a HN, because you can see the area quite extensively, like it is like doing a single section. So you can have the first slide for HN and the remaining slides for the special stage. So coming on to specimen handling, we'll have to make sure that the crushing artifact should not be there. So we'll have to minimize any kind of crushing artifact. So a biopsy will be required for a 2 to 4 hour fixation. After that, it has to be transferred to the disposable pipette, and proper care should be taken not to crush the tissue. At most centers, the technician does the grossing. So we'll have to train the technician on how to gross. Certain liver biopsies might be quite long. So a long biopsy cannot be put on as a whole. So we'll have to cut it. So care should be taken not to crush the tissue. And this set of special stages will be required to have for all the cases. So it may be any kind of case, maybe an already diagnosed case of liver pathology, but still it will be mandatory for the biopsy to have all these special stages. Like this is the slides which we do it routinely. And copper stain, reticulin, TAS-TST, pearl, trichrome will be required. And the copper stain, what we use is orsin or rhodanin. So copper stains, the copper associated proteins, rhodanin stains the copper itself. And the orsin, it will be useful to stain the elastic fibers also. When it comes to differentiating between necrosis and fibrosis, orsin is very helpful, because the necrosis will not show elastic fiber staining with the orsin stain in the necrotic area, whereas fibrosis will show the elastic fibers, which I'll be telling about it later. And for ground glass inclusions in hepatitis, chronic hepatitis C infection, and obviously I told you copper associated proteins will be stained with that. Then reticulin, to see the framework, the architecture of the liver biopsy, and to demonstrate fibrosis also, we'll be requiring reticulin. Then the CAS-TST, I think most of you would be knowing that it is required to see alpha-1 antitrypsin globules, but it has other uses also, like diastase. PAS will be required to see for the macrophages, which will be staining in a post-viral setting, post-viral hepatitis or an acute hepatitis which is resolving. These macrophages will be stained positive, and it has significance. Like, so we can say if the viral normal. But the presence of these macrophages, we can know that the patient had an episode of an acute hepatitis. So that will be very useful. And the other use of the PASD is that you can see the basement membrane of the bile duct. So when it comes to seeing the bile duct structures in the portal tract, the diastase PAS stain will be helpful. And then the PAS. I know the you must be knowing that the PAS will be staining the glycogen and the hepatocyte, and for other storage disorders it will be useful. But apart from that, since the hepatocytes normally stain for PAS, when you use them, it will be useful to highlight the fat vacuoles which are present. Mainly when it comes to microvascular steatosis, the fat vacuoles are so small, around 1 micron in size, you will not be able to see them in the HME section. It will be very useful if you take a PAS and see that. And then obviously the hepatocytes will be staying very dark, and when you compare them with the portal tract, they will be staying light. So to demark these, or to delineate the periportal area, this will be very useful. And the first thing, everyone will be knowing that it is for iron, and since it has a frame counter in the neutral thread, it will be useful to demonstrate cholestasis. Sometimes you will be having confusion with some pigment, if it is a lipofuscin or not. You can differentiate obviously on HME, but you know, you can pick it up so very well on pulse stain because of the frame counter stain. And then the trichrome to help the highlight the collagen in fibrosis. Necrosis will be having a frame stain, so you can differentiate the necrosis with a specimen. But whenever the necrosis is lit, then you might have a strong staining also. So we'll have to rely on austin staining when it comes to late necrosis, a late stage of a necrosis. So adequacy will be a good long biopsy, which is at least 2 to 2.5 centimeters with 11 portal tracts. You know, a biopsy needs to be of proper length and adequate portal tract, because there might be an underinterpretation of the grading and staging. Because in a macronodular cirrhosis, you might tend to think that there is maybe an incomplete cirrhosis or just a bridging fibrosis, since the size and the number of portal tracts aren't adequate. So it always needs to be adequate, that is 2 to 2.5 centimeters or 11 portal tracts need to be there. So how do I approach a liver biopsy? So first, you have to have the adequate size and the adequate number of portal tracts, and then you will have to see the overall architecture on low power. So you're going to see the scar pattern, which I'll be describing later, and the relation of the hepatocytes with the portal tract and the terminal hepatic tissue. After the architecture, you're going to go to the portal tract to see the structures in the portal tract, the inflammatory cells, the fibrosis. Then you're going to go to the lobules, which will be comprised of the hepatocytes, the transocytes, and other structures. Then you're going to see the terminal hepatic venule, if there is some pathology in that or surrounding that in the zone 3, the perivenular hepatocytes. Then you're going to use the initial special thing to add on to your diagnosis, which is made in the HME. And then additionally, if you require anything else, like an immunohistochemistry, you can go for that. So this is a schematic diagram which is showing a terminal hepatic venule in the center, and the portal tracts which are surrounding this hexagonal structure with a good linear arrangement of the hepatocytes. And this is a histological image where you can see this similar kind of cot pattern, that is we call the single cot pattern, which is clearly seen here, and this is the terminal hepatic venule right over here, and this is the portal tract. So based on this appearance, we have divided into three zones, the zone 1, zone 3. The zone 1 are the hepatocytes which are immediately surrounding the portal tract. The zone 3 are the perivenular hepatocytes, which are surrounding the terminal hepatic venule. And between this, excuse me, is the mid-zonal hepatocyte. So, the structures in the portal tract. So, what all you will see? You will see the bile duct, you will see the hepatic artery. I think you will be able to see these bile ducts over here. And the small muscular structure will be the hepatic artery. Then is the portal vein and lymphatic cells can be there. And few inflammatory cells can be normally present also. So then is the limiting plate. That will be the layer of the hepatocytes which immediately surround the portal tract. So that is called the limiting plate. And these are the hepatocytes, and between them you see the sinusoid. And here is the terminal hepatic venule. And what you see here is some brown staining of the hepatocytes. I think you can clearly see them. These are nothing but lipofuscin, is a degenerative pigment which can get accumulated here. And these sinusoids are lined by specialized endothelial cells. And just giving a clue, I think maybe the juniors would not be knowing. These are not stained with CD31 or 34 like the usual endothelial cells in any of the vessels. So they are a kind of a specialized endothelial cell. And when you do a CD31 and 34, they might show a faint staining in a normal liver parenchyma. Whereas when you take a hepatocellular carcinoma, you will demonstrate the CD31 and 34 staining will be seen in a hepatocellular carcinoma. Just a hint, I'm not going to talk about neoplastic pathology here. So, as I told you, we'll be going on to the architecture of the liver biopsy. So, there are two terminologies. One is called the lobular disarray, and then is the distortion of the lobular architecture. So, what do you mean by disarray? Disarray is that I have shown you in the normal histological image the single cord pattern of the hepatocyte. So here, what you will see that there will be complete loss of the single cord pattern. You cannot demonstrate if there is anything really like a cord pattern over here. So all the hepatocytes are haphazardly arranged, and there's so much of kind of a degenerative change which is going on along with the small inflammatory cells which are infiltrating. So this is called as disarray. So that is the cord pattern is completely lost, which is seen in acute hepatitis. Or it is actually a regenerative activity of the hepatocyte, and also in acute hepatitis when there is damage, you will be demonstrating loss of hepatocyte. Then we call distortion is that I have shown you a schematic diagram with the terminal hepatic venule in the center and the portal tract surrounding the radiating hepatocyte. That relation is completely lost. So here, because of the fibrosis or necrosis, the relation of the hepatocytes to the terminal hepatic venule and the portal tract will be lost, and this is termed as distortion of the lobular architecture. So the two terminologies are different. So disarray you will be using in acute hepatitis. Distortion you will be using in a chronic hepatitis. Acute hepatitis, then there is bridging necrosis. Suppose there is a centroportal bridging necrosis, you can use this terminology as a distortion of lobular architecture. And if there is a focal area which is showing distortion, like when you see an incomplete cirrhosis or a bridging fibrosis, you can tell that there is focal distortion of lobular architecture. So next, going on to the portal tract. So when you go and focus on the portal tract, you will be seeing the inflammatory cells in the portal tract. So what type of inflammatory cells are there and the other pathologies which will be seen. So initially I will be starting with the neutrophils. So if there is a predominance of neutrophils, it is not like in other tissues where presence of neutrophils will demonstrate or will indicate that it is an acute inflammation. No. It is not the same. So here, the neutrophil presence has certain indications, like in the portal tract or in the lobules. So if it is there in the portal tract, and if it is associated with Doppler reaction and edema along with neutrophils. It is due to a large duct obstruction. So we will have to think of a large duct. If it is an intraluminal presence, that is the neutrophils are present intraluminally within the Doppler structure, then we will have to think of something like an ascending cholangitis, that is infection of the biliary tree. And if the neutrophils are more abundant in the portal tract, they are plenty in number, then we will have to think in terms of a drug-induced liver injury or a hepatitis E infection. And we will also have to keep in mind that this Doppler reaction, which I will be talking about it later, since it is about neutrophils, I have to put that also here. So the Doppler reaction, because of production of some cytokines, there will be neutrophils at that particular site. So autoimmune hepatitis or viral hepatitis, which will elicit a Doppler reaction, might show some scattered neutrophils along the area where there is Doppler reaction. So do not get confused with the presence of neutrophils in an autoimmune hepatitis or a viral hepatitis. It can be seen also. Then coming on to the lobular presence of neutrophils. If it is a neutrophilic sarcoidosis, I think you'll know what neutrophilic sarcoidosis is. I think even as an MBBS student, you'll be knowing what neutrophilic sarcoidosis is. So you'll be seeing more commonly in alcoholic steatohepatitis hepatitis, but you can demonstrate neutrophilic sarcoidosis even in non-alcoholic steatohepatitis hepatitis also. But there are other differentiating features. Then if there is a focal collection or a microabscess formation, try to look in for a CMV inclusion in a proper setting, because with the focal collection, there will be some hepatocytes or endothelial cell which might show a CMV inclusion. So look for that. So then coming on to the eosinophils. So presence of eosinophils does not always indicate that the patient is having a drug-induced liver injury. It can also be present in autoimmune hepatitis also, and in some parasitic infestations or a hypereosinophilic syndrome, the eosinophils can be present. And we'll have to keep in mind that absence of eosinophils also does not rule out a drug-induced liver injury. It has a varied kind of pathological stage. It can present like an acute hepatitis or chronic hepatitis, severe hepatitis, so on. So presence or absence does not really indicate that it is a drug induced. Maybe it might be a supporting factor to look in for a drug history. Then is the plasma cell. So it is almost the most important cell in a liver biopsy. So most of the clinicians will be so interested to ask whether the plasma cells are present or not, because you know, whenever the viral markers are not there, so you can think of an autoimmune hepatitis in a proper setting. So a presence of plasma cell will indicate something like autoimmune hepatitis or can be seen in a PBC or a primary biliary cholangitis. Acute and chronic viral hepatitis also can show a lot of plasma cells apart from the lymphocytes which are present. Then coming on to the lymphoid aggregate. So lymphoid aggregate, where all you can demonstrate, like it is usually seen primary biliary cholangitis or primary sclerosing cholangitis. It also can be seen in hepatitis C viral infection. Very rarely it can be seen in an autoimmune hepatitis also. This in a PBC and the PSC, this lymphoid aggregate usually represents the area of a damaged or destroyed bile duct. On the serial, continuous serial, the area which shows the lymphoid aggregate can be correlated with the other area in the subsequent sections to demonstrate for a damaged bile duct. So that can be kept in mind. Actually, this is a case of hepatitis C viral infection, which is showing as the lymphoid aggregate over here. Then coming on to the granuloma, this is a sarcoidosis patient, already diagnosed patient with this large epithelial cell granuloma within the portal tract. So when we get a granulomatous hepatitis, we'll have to have a systematic approach. So first we'll have to take a proper history, whether like this previous case, the clinician himself will say that the patient was having a sarcoidosis, but other conditions like a systemic infection, or a significant drug history will help us. And the location of the granuloma is also very important, whether the granuloma is in the portal tract or is it in the lobule. So if it is in the portal tract, where do you see the granuloma? Is it in relation to the bile duct? So is it very close to the bile duct which is showing some reactive ACTH, or is it close to a bile duct which is getting damaged? Then you will think more in terms of PVC. And you know, this PVC can also show lobular granulomas, but they are usually smaller and it will be like a small aggregate of epithelial disc. It's not a well-formed typical granuloma. And if it is lobular, it's more favored like a sarcoid disease or other infective conditions. Types of granulomas are also important. As I said, the PVC will mostly show ill-formed or small granulomas, but whereas infective causes and other sarcoidosis and other conditions might cause a well-defined large granuloma. So the nature of granuloma, whether it is a non-necrotizing, ACA-taking, suppurative, we think of infective causes, and then fibrin ring, some drugs can cause that, and whether it is a lipogranuloma. So if it is associated with stiffer hepatitis, then we think of more like a lipogranuloma. Then coming on to the structures in the portal duct, that is the main important structure will be the bile duct. So this particular case which I have shown is a vanishing duct of a young girl who had been taking augmentin, that is amoxiclav. And the patient presented with the obstructive symptoms, obstructive jaundice. And in the biopsy, there was a lot of canalicular cholestasis, which was looking completely bland. It was a bland cholestasis. But when we saw the portal tract, we were not able to demonstrate the bile ducts in the portal tract. And before talking about this, I should say that in a normal biopsy, a normal liver biopsy, up to 7 to 9% of the portal tracts might not show a bile duct. So it can be normally there. So it means that when you are examining 10 portal tracts in a normal liver biopsy, one portal tract might show absence of bile duct. So it doesn't mean that the patient is having a vanishing bile duct syndrome or a paucity of bile duct. So you will have to take into consideration that more than 50% of the portal areas or the portal tracts show lack of bile duct. Then it is called as paucity of the bile duct, and it can be like C7 can be used, the cytotoxin 7 can be used to highlight the bile duct. Like what we see here is the absence of the bile duct, which is complete absence of staining for CK7, which we can see here. These slight stained brown colored cells, which are seen, are intermediate hepatobiliary cells and not the bile duct epithelial cells. So this patient unfortunately developed a cirrhosis within 6 or I think 1 year time and went on for a liver transplantation. So while taking the portal tract in a cholestatic liver disease, looking for bile duct also. So next is ascending cholangitis. So I've already told in the previous slides while talking about neutrophils that presence of neutrophils within the lumen of the bile ductules will indicate that there is some infection of the biliary tree. Like in this case here, we saw a lot of neutrophils with the kind of an expansion. And I told you this edema, which is very important. This is not fibrosis. This is a pale staining of the cold tract. This is edema. And a lot of neutrophils which are entering into the ductular structure. So this gives a sense that patient is having an ascending cholangitis. If not, you have to think something in terms of a large duct obstruction. So then is the primary biliary cholangitis. This is the pleural duct lesion or the initial portal hepatitis, sorry, portal inflammation stage, where you see a lot of inflammation in the portal tract with reactive changes of the bile duct epithelium. The cells, the nucleus are showing nucleoli and there's abundant cytoplasm with a lot of lymphocytes infiltrating and destroying. And you see a stained big epithelial cell granuloma right over here. Here you can see a very nice interface with the hepatocyte, and you do not see any spillover of these inflammatory cells into the hepatocyte. So there is absolutely no inflammation of the hepatocyte. But I should say that a primary biliary cholangitis might show some kind of also. It is, or if there is spillover of these lymphoplasmacytic cells into the hepatocyte, it doesn't mean that we are dealing with the overlap phenomenon. We'll have to have proper clinical supportive evidence saying that there is a autoimmune phenomenon also. We will be talking about that later in the slide, or I think maybe the next session. But for now, I'm showing the fluorid bile duct change, which we see with primary biliary cholangitis. Then this is a case of primary sclerosing cholangitis, where you can see a lot of onion skin and fibrosis around this bile duct. You can compare that with the normal bile duct which is seen over there. This is just a, am I, sir, Dr. Naveen? Hello? 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 Naveen? Am I audible to everyone? Can anyone put in the comments? Okay. I just want to share an image. So can you please tell what this structure is? Yeah, I think we got that. So someone has replied it is amyloid, exactly. So yeah, this is amyloid here. We see this enlarged hepatic artery with the deposition on the wall, and this is the bile duct. So you don't have to get confused that whether it is a primary sclerosing cholangitis or some other pathology related to the duct. It's just the amyloid deposit. So then coming on to the Doppler reaction. So Doppler reaction has a similar significance. Like it can be seen in various pathological conditions. So in a cholestatic liver disease, in a chronic liver disease, you can demonstrate lot of Doppler reaction, also in autoimmune hepatitis. So in a cholestatic liver disease, what happens is the along the interface, that is the periportal area, you will see a lot of Doppler reaction, and the center will be having less amount of ductules. So this will be a helpful feature to differentiate it from the other conditions which show Doppler reaction. So why does this happen? Why Doppler reaction happens? This is basically a reactionary change or to the damage of the periportal hepatocyte. So we have stem cells or the progenitor cells in the canal of hearing. So when there is a damage of the periportal hepatocyte, these cells undergo a modification and they appear as bile duct, or they develop a bile duct phenotype and are seen as bile ductular reactions. So you see this lot of these structures over here, and you can also see a very good bile duct which is seen over here, which will usually show a proper lumen and will have a proper basement membrane, whereas the bile ductular structures will not show a proper basement membrane, and usually they don't show proper lumen. So it will be kind of an anastomotic tubular structure So with that, we can differentiate whether it is a bile ductular reaction or a true bile duct. And in a CLD, chronic liver disease, when there is fibrosis, you might see a lot of ductular reaction also. But how you can differentiate is that, like in a cholestatic liver disease, you will be seeing a lot of ductular reaction along the interface, that is the periportal area. Whereas in a CLD, you will be seeing them within the portal area, or they are haphazardly distributed, not along the periportal area. So they can be haphazardly distributed here and there. So you don't have to get confused with that. And talking about interface hepatitis, when you see a lot of these inflammatory cells in the portal tract, they spill into the hepatocytes, causing destruction of the periportal hepatocytes. With a lot of ductular reaction, then it is called interface hepatitis. And interface hepatitis indicates that the patient is having a chronic hepatitis. So whether there is fibrosis or interface hepatitis, you will have to interpret whether the patient, the biopsy is showing interface hepatitis or a fibrosis of the portal tract, which will indicate that the patient is having chronic hepatitis. This can be highlighted with the trichrome, where you see a lot of Doppler reaction with a lot of damage to the peripheral hepatocytes here. So, going on to the pathology, which involves the hepatocytes. So, we will be seeing the listed ones over here. So, I will be starting with the steatosis. So, first going for the macrovesicular steatosis. So, what happens in a macrovesicular steatosis, there will be excess accumulation of lipid within the individual hepatocyte, and the hepatocyte nucleus will be pushed on to the side, and this can initially start as a small droplet within the hepatocyte, which will be seen over here like this, and the next image also you will see a lot of these lipid fine vacuole which will be accumulated within the hepatocyte. This might push the nucleus to one side, or in certain cases the nucleus will be in the center only. So you must be sure that these are the small droplet steatosis of the macrovesicular type and not the microvesicular steatosis. I'll just try to repeat it. So this is not the microvesicular type of steatosis. This is a small droplet type of macrovesicular steatosis, because the other one has different significance. So I am just stressing upon this point. And see here, you are able to see this lipogranuloma also. So there will be a fat which will be surrounded by the epithelial hepatocyte. It actually is a reactionary change to the tetrahydrofatty hepatocyte. And where all you will see macrovesicular steatosis? The location is also very important. So if it is seen in the perivenular region, that is the zone 3, it will be usually seen with alcoholic liver disease, in non-alcoholic fatty liver disease of the NASH, in obesity, in diabetes, and corticosteroid therapy. If it is seen in the peripheral area, you will have to think of, particularly in a pediatric setting, you will have to think of NAFLD in children, and protein allergy, malnutrition, total parental nutrition, and age will also result in periportal steatosis, macrovesicular type. So then the ballooning with Mallory Helen. So you see the hepatocyte over here, which is enlarged edematous with the completely retracted cytoplasm. You are seeing lot of Mallory hyaline here. Here Mallory dense bodies also, they are called as Mallory dense bodies also. So the presence of ballooning in a setting of a steatosis indicates that the patient is having steatohepatitis. So a biopsy showing steatosis with the presence of few lobular inflammation doesn't mean that the patient is having steatohepatitis, but the presence of ballooning indicates that the patient is having steatohepatitis. You can take it as a point. And suppose if you are having a doubt whether the hepatocytes are truly showing ballooning or not, So in those cases, you can use a cytoperitoneal typing staining. So like here, you can see a lot of these hepatocytes with the fat vacuum showing the cytotoxin staining. But these ones which are showing this Mallory halin, they will be showing either a reduced staining or a complete absence of the staining in these hepatocytes. So they can be used in a particular case when you have difficulties in demonstrating the balloon hepatocytes. Then in the microvesicular steatosis, as I told you, it has to be differentiated from the macrovesicular steatosis. Here you will see a lot of these hepatocytes with the small round lipid vacuoles, which will be difficult to demonstrate in a HME session. You will be that you'll be needing a maybe in a frozen tissue, frozen section. You can use oil redo, but if the patient person is not, if the clinician is not suspecting, then you will have to rely on a stain like PAS, where all the hepatocytes will be stained because of the glycogen, but the lipid droplets will not be stained, so it will be easily highlighted with the PAS stain. And this indicates the mitochondrial damage, so it is seen in specific conditions. So there will be excess of triglyceride accumulation in macrovesicular steatosis. Here will be a mitochondrial damage, like in cases of alcoholic foamy degeneration, acute fatty liver of pregnancy, valproate toxicity, and other conditions like Reed syndrome. You can see this microvesicular steatosis. In alcoholic foamy degeneration, the slide the biopsy might be showing absolutely very minimal fatty chain in a patient, and this can be picked up with proper training. It can be easily picked up the microvesicular steatosis, and you will also be able to demonstrate cholestasis also. And this has a good prognosis, because once the alcohol is stopped, I think this the alcohol foamy degeneration will go away. So can anyone tell what this is? I'm not able to see the screen. I just can anyone comment what that could? Yeah. Okay, so the Gotchers, some people have thought it is Gotchers, but actually, see, you are able to see this kind of rod-like structures, long rod-like structures over here. Megamitosis, yeah, thank you. So I think whenever I ask, I think someone can unmute and answer. I don't know, I'm not able to hear from Dr. Nadi. So never mind. Actually, these are mega mitochondria, and where do you see them?
Alcoholic liver disease.
Yeah, alcoholic liver disease. We can see them in non-alcoholic liver disease also, like NASH. Wilson's disease also can show, and some pregnancy related conditions also can show mega mitochondria. So please keep that in mind, because in alcoholic steatohepatitis, some of the clinicians might ask for presence of mega mitochondria. So then coming on to the glycogenated nuclei, so you can see a lot of this nucleus of the hepatocyte showing this kind of pale appearance, a clear appearance. This is seen in diabetes mellitus, in adolescents. In pediatric setting or in adolescence, you can see this glycogenated nucleus until the age of 14-15 years. So maybe normally also you can see that doesn't require to be pathological change. So then you can see them in NASH and in Wilson's disease also. Do not confuse these glycogenated nuclei for some viral inclusion. So just you have to keep that in mind. So can anyone name a genetic cause of steatosis in a non-obese patient? So I'm talking about the non-alcoholic type. So steatosis in a non-obese patient, a genetic cause. Can anyone answer it? Can unmute and answer?
Sir,
enzyme
deficiencies like inherited disorders like tyrosinemia and
we are thinking about like AF beta lipoproteinemia and maybe a thing where you can use the special stain, sir, a special stain to diagnose that, like our routine special stain which I had shown you, like first then you have the trichrome reticulin, opsin, everything. So that we can make a diagnosis, at least in some cases, not in all cases. Has anyone commented? Is anyone going to comment? Okay. Wilson's disease. So Wilson's disease can be suspected even in older age. And if the patient is having a lot of Mallory hyaline glycogenated nuclei, you think of, it might look like completely like a steatohepatitis. You'll have to think of a Wilson's disease also. Maybe the clinical findings will be also helpful. And can anyone name two infections which can cause steatosis, which I've already discussed?
Hepatitis C virus infection.
HIV also can cause steatosis. Okay. So let's go on to the next slide. So stellate cell hypoplasia. I have not seen this, but vitamin A toxicity or treatment using retinoids can cause stellate cell hypoplasia, and they appear foamy and bubbly. They are present in the sinusoidal area. So it might give an appearance of a steatosis. So we'll have to cautiously have a look. And if we find the stellate cell hypoplasia, and if we are not having a proper history of vitamin A toxicity, we'll have to ask for history of something like a drug. Herbal medication with some toxic levels of vitamin E. You'll have to think of that also. Can anyone tell what this is? I think this will be easy. I think you can go like more interactive. So if someone can mute and answer what this is, if you want to zoom, I can zoom it.
Ground glass appearance.
Correct. Ground glass appearance. Ground glass hepatocyte can be due to any cause, so we need to work it up properly. So if we have a proper clinical history of hepatitis B infection, then we can use the hepatitis B surface antigen IST to stain them. And if not, then we'll have to go for a PAS and PASD. If it is PAS positive diastase resistance, you have to think of more in terms of a glycogen storage disorder type 4 or a Lafora disease. If it is diastase sensitive, then think of cyanamide alcohol aversion therapy and transplantation or insulin treatment. Fibrinogen inclusions of PAS negative and IAT with fibrinogen can help demonstrating that. So this is another question slide you have. This particular, I think you can see this round structures over here. Getting the mouse. So you able to see this round structures over here. This is negative for antigen, that is the hepatitis B surface antigen, PAS and fibrinogen. Can anyone tell what this be? Please unmute it. I'm having some trouble actually.
It's having some lamellations. Corpora, I'm not sure whether if it is. I'm sorry, it's so upset.
Okay. Okay, so fine. This is actually not within the cytoplasm. It looks like something within the sinusoidal area. So if it is something within the sinusoidal area, what could you think of? So fine, okay. Please go ahead.
Amyloidosis, sir, but it should be linear.
Amyloid. So when you have this kind of negative staining, think of doing a congruent stain. So this is a globular amyloid deposit. So think of that as well. Then coming on to the I'm discussing about the hepatocellular changes. So here we'll be seeing about rosetting and ballooning degeneration. So what do you mean by hepatocellular rosette? Is that the linear arrangement or a single cord pattern of the hepatocyte will be lost, as we see in an acute hepatitis or a regenerative activity, and the cells will form a rounded structure giving a gland-like appearance with or without the central lumen, like we see here, and this indicates a regenerative activity or damage to the hepatocyte. It does not really indicate that the patient is having autoimmune hepatitis. It can be seen in any condition causing acute hepatitis. So it is not specific for autoimmune hepatitis. Talking about ballooning degeneration, this is different, completely different from the ballooning which we see in schizohepatitis. So that is called the hepatocellular ballooning. This will be called ballooning degeneration. This is seen in acute hepatitis, where the cytoplasm is more granular and fine, it is vacillated also, like what we see here, it is vacillated also. So this is completely different from the ballooning change which we see in schizohepatitis. And when we do a sequel 818 here, this will show normal staining of the hepatocyte. So then in the Jane cell transformation, where you can see that in the neonatal Jane cell hepatitis, in adults we are like post neonatal, we call it as post infantile Jane cell transformation. You can see them in autoimmune hepatitis. You can see them in hepatitis C infection without HIV infection.
Sir, your voice is not coming.
Oh, sorry.
Hello?
Am I audible now?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Now.
Dr. Rao, can you hear?
Yeah, I'm able to hear you, sir.
Now it is clear, sir. Now it is clear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, you can go. You can go on the time back, please, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fine. That's.
We'll be talking about this hepatocellular rosette and ballooning degeneration. So when we talk about hepatocellular rosette, it is actually a change which happens due to acute hepatitis or a regenerative activity of the hepatocyte, where the hepatocytes, they form a kind of a rounded gland-like structure with or without a central lumen. So this does not signify that the patient is having autoimmune hepatitis. It can be seen in any condition of acute hepatitis, be it a drug, be it a viral hepatitis. It can happen in any condition. And coming on to the ballooning degeneration is a kind of a damage or a degenerative change due to acute hepatitis, where you will see the granular or vacillated cytoplasm of the hepatocyte. Like what you see here is a vacillated cytoplasm of the hepatocyte, and they appear more granular also. So this is completely different from the ballooning change which we see in schizohepatitis. That the terminology has to be perfect. So here in an acute hepatitis, you call it as a ballooning degeneration. In schizohepatitis, you call it as a ballooning, hepatocellular ballooning or a balloon change or whatever, but don't call it as a ballooning degeneration. So this, if you do a cytokeratin 880, like what I showed in the previous slide, in this particular case, or in an acute hepatitis, so in ballooning degeneration, the staining pattern will be absolutely normal. So you will not demonstrate any loss or absence of CK18 staining. them as the benign transformation. You can see them in a neonatal genital hepatitis setting, or in adults you call them as post-infantile genital hepatitis, where it can be seen in autoimmune hepatitis or in a hepatitis C infection. Then going on to the cadaveric deep degeneration, this is happens in a cholestatic liver disease, and it is due to the accumulation of bile salts within the hepatocyte. And I just told you about the germ cell hepatitis. Here also you are able to demonstrate multinucleation or germ cell change. So germ cells can be seen in a cholestatic liver disease also. And talking about cadaveric degeneration, the cytoplasm is rarefied, and edematous like a ballooning chain, which you see in theater hepatitis. But you will demonstrate a lot of cholestasis. So you will not get confused when dealing with a cadaveric degeneration and a ballooning change in a theta hepatitis. So all three are different. So here this cadaveric degeneration, in acute hepatitis it is called ballooning degeneration, and in a theta hepatitis it is called balloon hepatitis. Next, going on to the main important topic, the full stage. So here you are able to see a lot of canalicular as well as hepatocellular cholestasis, and with a lot of steatosis also. So this is this photomicrograph, you can see a lot of canalicular cholestasis as well as hepatocellular cholestasis, but in both these images you are absolutely not able to see any inflammation at all. So this demonstrates that the patient is having a bland type of cholestasis, bland intrahepatic cholestasis. So what are the conditions causing these? So whenever you get something like this, you will have to think of sepsis, drug induced like a contraceptive use, or the earlier case which I have shown you, the augmentin intake, or a benign recurrent intrahepatic cholestasis, cholestasis of pregnancy, or in a post-transplant setting. Then here, this is a bile ductular structure with a bile staining within the lumen. So you can see that very well over here. This is from one article which I have taken. So this is called cholangitis lenta or ductular cholestasis. This has a known its own significance, that presence of this bile within the ductular structure indicates that the patient might have sepsis. So this study which was performed in 28 cases, found out that presence of cholangitis lenta on liver biopsy was associated with sepsis and higher mortality. So if you find some changes, any changes like this, you will need to inform and discuss with them accordingly, and you know what kind of management is required for the patient. And if you find more changes in the portal tract, which like what I showed you in the previous slide, like edema, inflammatory infiltrate, with the absence of this kind of ductular cholestasis, you are in terms of an obstructive or a large duct obstruction cause of cholestasis. So, as I said, ductular cholestasis will be in sepsis. For sepsis, like in adults and children, you will have to think of sepsis. And extrahepatic bile duct atresia in infants and ductal plate malformation will show ductular type of cholestasis. Canalicular cholestasis will be seen in all the other type of cholestatic syndrome. So then is the cholestatic rosette. So I have shown you the hepatocellular rosette, which will be seen in an acute hepatitis. Here in cholestatic rosette is nothing but a normal canaliculi, but has become dilated with multiple hepatocytes which are surrounding them. Usually a normal canaliculi will be showing 2 to 3 hepatocytes which will be surrounding the canaliculi with bile inside them. But here there are multiple hepatocytes, and the canaliculi will be dilated. And this canaliculi is showing good amount of bile here, but in certain cases the bile will be lost during processing and will be appearing as vacant rosette. So you have to see for them, and the presence without bile also indicate that the patient is having a cholestatic liver disease, you do not demonstrate bile in a cholestatic process. So just keep in mind that, and how to differentiate them from a hepatocellular cirrhosis. So if you find them without any inflammation or any hepatocellular damage, you can be sure that we are dealing with something like a cholestatic. Then you have to, when dealing with a cholestatic liver disease, you have to differentiate whether it is an acute cholestasis or a chronic cholestasis. Why? Because this is not important for the clinician point of view, but you can try to, you know, get to a confirmation of what kind of liver pathology you are dealing with. Whether it is something related to drug or sepsis, or is it something related to the biliary tree. Chronic cholestasis is usually related to the biliary tree. So the elevation of the ALP will be high, and you know, the bilirubin sometimes may be normal also. And there will be certain changes which is so classic for chronic cholestasis. That is, the peripheral hepatocytes will be showing swelling and pallor with the mammary dying body accumulation. There will be portal fibrosis, and the peripheral hepatocytes also will show some copper and copper associated protein accumulation. So this is the peripheral area, and the portal area, and this is the peripheral hepatocytes. These are the peripheral hepatocytes. They are showing this kind of a pallor, edematous appearance, and you are able to see some mammary dying bodies and some cholestasis also. And this is a rodent stain which demonstrates the copper which is accumulated in the peripheral hepatocyte in a chronic cholestasis. So because the copper is also excreted along with the bile, so these get accumulated in the peripheral hepatocyte in a case of chronic cholestasis. And this CK7 has also been useful in setting up a chronic cholestasis, because they can be used to demonstrate the peripheral hepatocytes will be stained for this CK7 in a sedimentary. Because you know, in a chronic cholestasis, there is an immunophenotypic alteration, so the peripheral hepatocytes will show positive staining, and you can see this bile duct structures which are stained with CK7. And the peripheral hepatocytes are also staying positive for CK7. And this is a study which has shown the usefulness of CK7 in a primary biliary cirrhosis. And what they have demonstrated is that with the increasing stage of primary biliary cholangitis, maybe the terminology is wrong here, but they have changed after 2013 the primary biliary cholangitis. So the intensity of the staining for CK7 increases as the stage increases. So the highest will be seen in the later stages. That most of the, suppose if it has transformed to a cirrhosis, all the whole nodule might get stained with CK7. So that will be a very helpful marker. And when you take in a cirrhotic patient and you want to differentiate is it due to a cholestatic or a pathology related to the biliary tree or some other pathology, you can use this cytokeratin 7 staining, which will clearly highlight the peripheral hepatocyte and thereby showing that it is something related to the bile duct. But you know, in autoimmune hepatitis, you can demonstrate some amount of cytokeratin staining, 7 staining, so it might not be that very helpful in autoimmune hepatitis to differentiate the autoimmune hepatitis from a primary biliary cholangitis. So when you get a cholestatic liver biopsy, or when there is morphological cholestasis, you will have to see whether it is a Doppler cholestasis or is it a hepatocellular cholestasis. So Doppler cholestasis, it might be seen as previously told, and if it is hepatocellular cholestasis, you will have to see the portal tracts. If the portal tracts are absolutely normal and the lobules are normal without any inflammation, then you term it as a bland cholestasis. So the list of bland cholestasis, mainly the drug, sepsis and pregnancy related conditions. And then you are going to see the portal tracts again, and if they are showing a lot of this Doppler reaction, in the previous slide where I have shown you, if there is Doppler reaction, with the neutrophils and erythematous appearance, you think of large set of surface. And if there is a lot of these mononuclear cells, I think these have to be together. The lot of mononuclear cells, the lymphoplasmacytic cells, along with the duct destruction, you will have to think in terms of PBC. And if there is ornithine fibrosis, you think of PSC. And as I showed, I've shown you in one case where there is absolutely no inflammation, but there is duct paucity, you have to think of a syndromic or a non-syndromic cause of bile duct paucity. So this is how you approach that. And when you get a cholestatic liver disease, you will have to see whether it is an obstructive, due to an obstructive cause or a non-obstructive cause, and then whether it's a bland cholestasis or not. Because, you know, if in a non-obstructive cause, it can be a bland cholestasis, or it can be an acute hepatitis which shows a lot of cholestasis. If it is a chronic liver disease or a cirrhotic liver biopsy which is showing cholestasis, it can be due to an acute exacerbation, or it can be a drug related or a sepsis related. So when you are having a chronic liver disease or a cirrhotic liver biopsy which is showing cholestasis, you will have to discuss with the clinician on what you are dealing with. And then whether it is a biliary cirrhosis with the chronic cholestasis, then about the portal tract changes, which I have previously told about, whether there is Doppler reaction and neutrophils and edema, you might come, in some cases, you might not demonstrate cholestasis in the hepatocytes. In such a condition, you will have to think of something like a transient obstruction, like a chronic pancreatitis or a acute cholecystitis. In some cases of biopsy from adjoining an area of a mass lesion, it can show this kind of portal changes. And if the obstruction is not involving that particular segment, then you will not be able to demonstrate cholestasis, but you will be able to see all the portal changes which will be there. And then you have to differentiate between a cholestatic liver disease with inflammation from an acute hepatitis with cholestasis. So with all the lobular changes which I have demonstrated earlier, you will be easily able to differentiate whether it is an acute hepatitis with cholestasis or is it a chronic liver disease with inflammation. Cholestatic liver disease with inflammation, like what happens in the primary biliary cholangitis. There will be a lot of inflammation in the portal tract, which can spread into the hepatocytes also. It can show a hepatocytic pattern also. That is the inflammation of the hepatocytes also it can show. And then it is steatohepatitis with cholestasis. When you find the steatohepatitis with cholestasis, you will have to think in terms of alcoholic hepatitis. And if there is no proper history of alcohol intake, then you will have to think in terms of drug-induced cholestasis. So I'll stop with this for today. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. You want to stop here?
Yes, sir. It's 1 hour, I'll stop.
There are few questions which we will take. Yeah. So let's go for the question which has been put up on the YouTube channel. Dr. Nabanita Das has a very pertinent question. She says, having 9 slides, as you showed that you have to take 9 sections and train them differently, in a resource-limited lab in peripheral part of the country, where it is not practical and feasible to have all these special stains, what do you see on HE and then decide which stains to do?
What I would say is, if you are having the special stains with you, the possibility of doing a special stain, then it is always better to go ahead with that. But if you are working in a limited setting, you will be restricted with that particular set of staining you're going to have. So you will have to use that right away. So suppose if you are having only trichrome and pearls, you will have to use those two stains right away along with the HNE, and not to wait for the changes which you see on the liver biopsy and go ahead with that. suppose you find some changes, like you are not able to standardize copper staining, like austin or a rhodanin, so what you can do is take sections and send it to a buddy or any reference institute where they are doing this staining, so that can be of help.
There's another question put up by Dr. Nishtha Ahuja.
Okay.
She has a question, how to differentiate between microvesicular steatosis and small droplets type of macrovesicular steatosis?
Yeah, so as I told, well, demonstrating that, like if we can go to the slide. I can show it on the slide, it'll be more better. So what we see here in a macrovesicular steatosis, you will be able to see a lot of this macrovesicular type where the nucleus are pushed to one side and there is a large vacuole within the hepatocyte, and this will usually be the perivenular region. And along with that, you will be able to see a lot of these small droplets, and they will be randomly distributed and there will be no pattern and all. But when you take a microvesicular steatosis, they can also show kind of a perivenular distribution in cases of alcoholic foaming degeneration, but they can be diffuse also. And the thing is, they are usually not associated with a macrovesicular steatosis until unless you have something like a drug-related therapy. Drugs can cause microvesicular steatosis, not the valproate. Certain other drugs can cause microvesicular steatosis, and even alcohol might show microvesicular and macrovesicular. Until unless you are dealing with such a condition, this will all mostly be diffuse, and you will not be able to demonstrate that so easily in a HNA. You will have to make use of the PAS, and since the PAS stains the glycogen so diffusely, it can hold inside the cytoplasm. So that is how, and you know, the cell size might more or less be the same. It will not be so enlarged or the edematous. So the cell size will be more or less the same as compared to a normal hepatocyte. And these vacuoles will be finely distributed within cytoplasm. So by these things, you can differentiate the macrovesicular and the macrovesicular.
Thank you, sir.
Anybody else wants to ask any question can unmute their mic and ask a question directly to Dr. Rajaguru.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, please.
Sir, can you again explain interface hepatitis?
Yes, yeah. So what happens in an interface hepatitis is the inflammatory cells in the portal tract, they spill over to the lobules. And in that process, it causes lot of destruction of the periportal hepatocyte. And there will be a reactionary change, that is the bile duct reaction happens in that particular area where there is spillover and damage of the periportal hepatocyte. If you want me to show the image, I can show that, or if this explanation is sufficient, I can stop with that. Any particular kind of doubt you have when you are dealing with an interface hepatitis?
Any specific thing which you would like to know from Dr. Rajaguru?
No, sir.
Oh, is that okay with you?
Yes.
Is that okay with you? Can I throw the image to you?
No, sir. Thank you, sir.
There is a comment from Dr. Khoja who says that we can do three sections, one HE, one retic, and one Mason's trichrome as mandatory, and then review it further on from there. This is with regards to Dr. Gopalita Das's comment on the YouTube.
Oh, okay.
Anybody else?
Yeah, that can be done.
Anybody else wants to ask any question, anything related to the talk today or their personal experience where they want to have any clarification? Now, there is another question from YouTube. Dr. Rajaguru, would you like to take that?
Yes.
It says, Dr.
Navin,
can we differentiate alcoholic steatohepatitis versus NASH in biopsy? Any update?
Definitely. I will be speaking about that on the Friday, on Friday. So we'll be discussing. So that will be a separate session altogether.
That's wonderful. I think Dr. Navanit Das can wait till Friday. She can get her queries answered on Friday. And she also has another question with that, saying any update on etiology of NASH in Asian population. So we will take all that on Friday.
There is another question, sir. Should I answer that? I think
please. Yeah. How do we assess it? Can you explain?
Microvesicular. How do we assess interface hepatitis in explant cirrhosis?
Yeah.
So how do we assess interface hepatitis in explant cirrhosis? Why do we need to assess interface hepatitis in explant cirrhosis? I don't think so. It is really required to assess interface hepatitis in you mean to say the scoring? Okay, the HII scoring or the ISHAS, the grading. For the grading, you can do it as mentioned. You know, there is a grading, there are different types of grading, and you can use it. I think so. I think that will be sufficient. I think there is nothing like this. It will be an overall, microscopic. Grading which you will have to do, that is the circumference, how many portal areas are involved, and what is the circumference involved. So you can see the ISHAS grading system, and you can grade accordingly. And there is another, microvesicular and macrovesicular will affect the prognosis. Is that a question or is it an answer? Hello? Dr. Nabi?
Yes, please tell me. Hello?
There is a comment. Microvesicular and macrovesicular in the prognosis. So is that a comment?
I think that's a comment rather than. There is another question. How do we assess interface hepatitis? Sorry, we have done that. Can you explain disarray and distortion of architecture?
Yes, I can do that. So when you talk about disarray, you are dealing with something like an acute hepatitis. So you see the biopsy on low power and you are seeing that the cord pattern is completely lost. That is the single cord pattern which stays until till the age of 4. So that single cord pattern is completely lost and you have a kind of a 2 or 3 cord pattern, or you're not able to demonstrate the cord pattern completely. So that is called disarray. And in that setting, you will see a lot of hepatocellular regenerative changes. This actually happens because of hepatocellular regeneration. You will see a lot of rosetting, lot of lobular inflammation, degeneration of the hepatocytes, what we say it as ballooning degeneration. So there will be a lot of these changes. This is lobular disarray. And when you talk about distortion, it happens in a chronic liver disease or in a cirrhosis or an incomplete cirrhosis or bridging fibrosis, where the relation of the terminal hepatic venule to the portal tract, that is the center terminal hepatic venule with radiating hepatocytes, that is in a wedge biopsy. Maybe if you take a liver biopsy, you will be seeing absolutely no fibrosis at all in the portal tract or in the around the terminal hepatic venule. And the relation of the hepatocytes with the structure will be maintained. And if there is a fibrosis or a necrosis, this relation will be completely lost. So this is called distorsion. So is my explanation okay?
Yeah. I think that's very clear. Dr. Nuzhat Sayed Nuzhat has a question. Dr. Sayed Nuzhat, can you just unmute your mic and ask the question directly, please? Because he has typed a thing on the chat, sir, grading or fibrosis or steatosis. I mean, I can't understand that. So, Dr.
Sayed, I think what the doctor has, I think, is the question was supposed to be, is the grading for fibrosis or steatosis? No, fibrosis is called aging. Grading is like, steatosis, what you use is grading. So, how much grade of steatosis is there? Can be grading. Nobular inflammation, ballooning pain can be grading. And fibrosis is called stage. So, what stage of fibrosis is that? So, those two are completely different. Yeah, we do grading. We grade, you know, if it is less than 5%, it is insignificant. Then if it is 6 to 33, I think, so 33 to 66 and more than 66%. So that is how we grade.
There is another, I would say, not a question, it's a suggestion. For next session, yes, in a background of cirrhosis, diagnosing regenerative nodule versus well-differentiated HCC pitfalls. So you are in demand.
So they want that. Okay, definitely I can add that also. I have not covered plastic part, but never mind. If they have asked that, I can do that, sir, very well, no problem.
Yeah, I'll just repeat it. For next session, in a background of cirrhosis, diagnosing regenerative nodule versus well-differentiated HCC pitfalls.
Yeah, okay. So, if the person is well-versed, I think he himself will be knowing the answer, but I will discuss about that, but they have to keep in mind about two things. One is reticulin and the other is glycogen cancer. Yes, we will be talking in that.
Right.
Yes, sir. Anything else?
Anything else? Anybody wants to ask any question? And Dr. Rajaguru is definitely tired now, exhausted.
No. You do it. So,
okay, so let me make the final.
I think that there must have been some shortcomings. You know, this is the first time I am doing an online session. So, since there is no one nodding in front and there is no one, which everything is virtual, so it is like sitting in front of no one.
Yeah, that's a different experience altogether. But let me tell you, Dr. Rajaguru, you have done a wonderful job. It is you have taught hepatology from its alphabets A, B, C, D. Yes. Generally, people would pick up a particular disease and talk about it, but then you have taken the trouble of explaining various manifestations on histology and how to put them together and formulate a diagnosis, which is a very difficult job. And it's very simple to just talk about acute hepatitis and this is happening and that is happening, rather than talking about various features on an histology slides in a liver biopsy and what every particular feature exactly, you know, relates to. It's a tough job and I think you've done a wonderful job. There were some issues with the sound. I think we will be able to overcome that. I will explain it. I mean, we will work it out exactly. There was some problem with the sound. People were not able to hear things clearly in between. I think that's something to do with the net, something to do with maybe the audio system which we were trying to use. But anyway, that we will get sorted out. This entire video is available on the YouTube. We will be uploading a slightly edited version also on YouTube, because I can assure you what applies to me applies to everybody. One shot will not be sufficient. We have to listen to this over and over again to really understand hepatology and hepatopathology. Thank you so much, Dr. Rajaguru. There is a comment here. Sir, this lecture was so amazing, yet basics were explained in a very simple way. Thank you, sir. Hope to learn more from you. So that is, I think, the, you can say, the signing off note. And a Thank you so much, Dr. Rajguru. Thank you, everybody, for joining in. We are again meeting on Friday, exactly 7:30, for a much more detailed version of liver pathology. Thank you.